Okay, so first, thank you very much, Tom, for inviting me. So I'll talk about reinforced random walks and more generally about self-interacting random walks. So these are walks which keep a memory of their past. This memory can be, for instance, the number of visits to sites or number of crossings of edges, and then they interact with that memory. So, for instance, if they are reinforced, they will be more likely to visit again sites that have been already visited, or edges that have been already crossed. And if they are self-repelling, then they will avoid these sites. So I'll do the following. First, I'll do a short overview of self-interacting random walks. So I won't be able to cover everything because it's a huge topic. So I'll start by a definition and introduction, and I'll make some simple computations to give a good intuition on the type of behavior that you can expect. And then I'll discuss localization results. So localization is not in the sense of statistical physics. It's really localization of the walk. So it can happen for a certain type of reinforcement that you eventually get stuck on a finite number of vertices. So that's what I will call localization in the first part of the talk, because in the second part, I will discuss the use of localization from statistical physics to prove results about these walks. But these localization results are about getting stuck in a subset of vertices, and they happen for a certain class of reinforcement. And at the phase transition for this class of reinforcement, there is a linear case. And the linear case is particularly interesting because it has links to various topics, to statistics, and actually, so as we will see in the talk, to statistical physics. So first, I'll discuss the first results, which were obtained starting from the inception of the model by Percy Diaconis and Coppersmith in 86 up to 2009. And then I will discuss the new approach that was introduced that enabled to make this connection with statistical physics. So on this linear case, which is at this phase transition. So what does it do that? So this link goes through, oh. So this link goes through, yes, it's just that I wanted to point, I didn't find the point. Ah, I see, okay. So this link goes through several steps. The first one is the link between the edge-reinforced random walk and another process called the vertex-reinforced jump process. This process was proposed by Wendelin Werner and later, and was introduced by Davis and Volkov. It turns out that this vertex reinforced jump process has a direct relationship with the supersymmetric hyperbolic sigma model in quantum field theory, which was studied by De Sartori, Spencer, and Zirnbauer. And it has also other links, so in particular with a random Schrödinger operator and with Dynkin's isomorphism, or equivalently, the generalized version of Reinheit theorem. And then I'll discuss applications to recurrence and transience. So first, the model. So the self-interacting random walk, so it works on a non-oriented locally finite graph. So let me remove that thing here. Ah, but every time I remove. I have to leave the mouse here.
You should not leave the mouse.
Ah.
But you should pause it.
I have to pause it and then.
And then it'll disappear.
Okay, good. Thank you. So So we start with a graph G with vertices V and edges E, which is non-oriented and locally finite. So from every site you have a finite number of adjacent vertices. And we give ourselves for each edge E of the graph some weight functions, WE. So WE of N will be the weight you put to the fact that a vertex has been visited N times. Or an edge has been crossed n times. So, and what we call, so when we introduce this vertex self-interacting random walk, so we assume we start from a fixed vertex I naught. And now, if at time n we are at I, we look at the vertices which are adjacent to I, and we go to vertex j with a probability which is proportional to wij, so the function w on the edge ij of the number of visits to j. So zn of j, the number of visits to j, up to that time n. And then, so because this probability is proportional, it would be the quotient of the. Okay, I see now what's happening. Okay. So, what should I do now?
So, just leave it out of the way. The thing is, there's a button on there that when you press it, the mouse moves.
Okay. So, I think I need some tutorial on how to use slideshow. So the probability will be wij of zn of j, so to go from I to j at time n. So w of j of the number of visits up to time n at j divided by the sum of these terms over all adjacent vertices. And now if you want to define the edge reinforced on the walk, it's exactly the same definition, except that you replace the number of visits to the adjacent vertex by the number of visits to the number of crossings of the corresponding non-oriented edge, ij. So the number of visits from I to j and from j to I. So now the linear case, so what I will call the linear case in this talk, is a case where WE of n is AE plus n. So I will allow AE to depend on the edge E. And usually these walks in the linear case are called edge and vertex reinforced random walk, although they are actually the linearly reinforced random walk. So ERRW and VRRW. And so they were introduced by Diaconis and Coppersmith in 1986. And the idea was that if you arrive in a new city, so if a person arrives in a new city, at first it wanders around randomly. But as time goes on, it's more likely to go back to the pubs it has already been to, or to go through the streets it has already visited. And the question is, what happens in the long run? So now let me briefly discuss some applications and related questions. So one is what is called reinforcement learning in game theory. So you can see, for instance, some simulations by Erev and Roth in the 90s. And the question is the following. So you have a certain number of people, let's say M people, who play repeatedly the same game. Each of them has D possible strategies. And they reinforce on their strategies according to their payoff. So let's assume, for instance, that payoff is positive. So then every time, they have a propensity to play its strategy. And the way they update this propensity is very simple. Every time they get a payoff, they increase the propensity by the payoff they get. So the propensity is simply the total payoff they got over at time n, let's say, plus a certain constant. And the question is, how asymptotically does this type of behavior, this type of process behave? And it was studied, for instance, for the creation of, so this model was used for studying the creation of social network or the creation of a new language. So in a society where people are so not behaving optimally, because if you behave optimally, you won't only reinforce, you will want to take the best decision according to the past. So here you are considering what economists call myopic learning, where you just have information about your own payoff, and you want to improve your strategies based on this information.
Is this related to an edge reinforced random walk? So what's the graph?
It's a good question. You can introduce a graph on that. So here, the way I present it, the graph is simply the complete graph. But in general, you could imagine that, for instance, if you create a social network, you allow only, let's say, one person will be allowed only to interact with a certain number of persons. So you can introduce some coefficients which will be zero for the others, and then that creates a graph. But so I won't have time to go into detail. I mean, it would need another talk to discuss this behavior.
But in this particular model, do you remember the far past or not?
Yes, you remember the far past. So you have your propensity is, so let's assume the payoffs are positive. Yeah. Your propensity is the full payoff you got. So over the whole period of time. So
for that particular strategy.
Yes. Yeah. So it has a memory of the past, but it's simple memory. It's not that you remember, for instance, what the other people were playing when you were playing that. So
you only remember your own.
Yeah, you're always, so it's a very simple strategy in the sense that you have only to care about your own payoff.
Why did you say the payoffs are positive?
Because if they are not positive, you cannot say that your propensity will be the total payoff, because this total payoff will be could be negative. And if it's negative and you have a linear rule, then you have to define. So that's why I said to simplify.
No, but you could build that in being kind of a repulsion.
Yes, of course. No. So that's why I say let's simplify and do that, but you can do in general. So, and then in biology, so there is, okay. So I really need some training. So, but reinforcement going on. So you have the trail formation for ants. I mean, it's well-known model. So the question is: so they leave these pheromones and. And at some point, they all go through the same path, and so you want to know how this occurs. So the difference with our model here is that usually when people want to have a mathematical framework for that, they put some non-backtracking work. So they avoid going back immediately through the same edge in the reverse direction, for instance. And so there is another model which is closer to the one we discussed, but it's a multi-particle model. It was introduced by Osmer and Stevens for the aggregation of myxobacteria. And the question was the following. So you assume that, so the biologists were observing that this bacteria has tendency to localize, to put themselves all together without observing any long-range interaction. And the question is, now they observe the following phenomenon, that these bacteria leave slime molds on which it's easier to glide. And their question is it possible to explain that aggregation behavior just out of this short-range interaction? And so they did simulations for that. And so here you see on the left, it's edge reinforcement. On the right is vertex interaction. And you immediately see, so here you take 1,000 particles after 1,000 iterations, and you go from black to gray as the number of visits increases. And you are to light gray as the number of visits increases. And you are simply white if there is no visit to the plate. And you see here that in the so the edge interaction scatters much more than the vertex one. So which is a bit counterintuitive. It looks very similar when you define it. So instead of reinforcing a number of visits to the site, you reinforce a number of visits crossing the edges. So what is the reason for that? So
what's the conclusion from this picture? The edges tend to reinforce
more? No, they reinforce less. They scatter more. So see here, dark is more is less visits, so it's more scattered.
Yeah.
So they scatter more, and so there are two explanations for that. So one is, the simple one is that the interaction distance for edge reinforcement is one instead of two. Because for vertex reinforcement, you don't look, so if you have, so here you don't look only at the number, so you are at I, you don't look only at the number of visits to the crossing from I to J, but also the number of crossings of all edges here, which make an interaction at distance two instead of one. So that's the short answer. You can have a slightly longer answer with a very simple computation. So in the linear case, so you take AE here equal to one. So simply, so it means that your WE of N is simply N plus one. And you do the following. So you assume that so far, let's say you started from zero, you are at time two N. And you spend half of the time in zero, the other half of the time equally divided between minus one and one. So let's assume here that N is even. And you haven't visited any of these sites here, two and three and minus two and minus three. So now you want to compute the probability starting from one to go to three. So for the vertex reinforced framework, it's easy to compute. So here, the zero number of visits will turn into one because the weight function is n plus one. So it will be one over n plus one. Multiply by 1 over n over 2 plus 1. So it will be of the order of 2 over n squared. And here now, if you take edge reinforcement, so the number of visits to the crossings of the non-oriented edge is n, because you visit, when you visit a vertex, you have to go back, right? So your probability will be 1 over n multiplied by 1 over 3. So it will be 1 over 3n. So now if you know a little bit of elementary probability, you know that in the first case, the sum converges here, and the second, it diverges. So and by Borel-Cantell lemma, you can expect that an event of that type for vertex reinforced random walk will only occur finitely often, whereas for edge reinforced random walk, you know that eventually that event will happen, that you will escape from that trap. So now the question, obviously here I'm cheating a little bit because you know that at some point you will have some visits to the site 2 and minus 2. Every now and then you have to do these seldom visits. But still the picture that I give here is right. You can have some localization for vertex reinforcement, whereas at linear rate, whereas you cannot have it for edge reinforcement. And so I explain the results later. Another thing you can do to get some intuition is to consider the simple case of a graph of three consecutive vertices. So from minus one, zero, and one. So on that graph, obviously, let's say you start, for instance, at zero. Or let's say take also an interaction function, which is polynomial, so n plus 1 to the alpha. So for that edge and for that edge. You take the same for the two. So now you want to compute you know that every half of the time you are at site 0. And the other half of the time, you share between site minus 1 and 1, right? But So it's only half of the time that you make a decision. But this decision you can encode in an earned model. So what you do is you put a number of green balls corresponding to, corresponding to the visits to minus one, and as many red balls as the number of visits to one. So what happens every time you are at zero, your probability to pick a green ball will be W of the number of green balls divided by W and number of green balls plus W of number of red balls, and then you'll put back the ball together with the ball of the same color. So this is what is called sometimes W earn model. And for people who know about polyearn, so the polyearn is just the case where alpha is equal to one. So it's a linear reinforcement. So it's a real earn, because here it's not natural to choose with respect to a function which is not linear. So now what happens for alpha less than one? So if alpha is less than one, you can prove by martingale techniques, by easy martingale techniques, that the number of visits to one and to minus one will be of the same order. So when you think about it, it's not that intuitive, because here I haven't assumed that alpha be positive. So alpha can be negative, and still I have the same type of behavior. So, and that's something that will come up several times in this talk, is that the difference is not so much between self-repellence and self-attraction or reinforcement, but much more between weak reinforcement and strong reinforcement. The linear case laying on the phase transition. So now, when alpha is greater than one, and more generally when W is reciprocally summable, you can show that in the end you'll choose one color, or you'll choose one site. So either you localize on these two vertices or on these two vertices. So again, you can either use martingale techniques, or you can use continuous time representation of the work to see that, of the earn to see that. So now the case alpha is equal to one is very well known. As I said, it's a polyearn model. So you know that you will converge. So the proportion of red balls will converge to beta random variables. Actually here, because I took exactly n plus one is simply the uniform random variable on 0, 1. It's a special case, but still interesting to notice.
So even with three slices, this is not a totally trivial thing. You already have to think.
So that's why I took some time to discuss this computation. So now localization results. So what are the conclusions that we draw from these remarks? So the first is, as I said, that the real phase transition is between weak and strong reinforcement. And the second is that there is a difference at that transition between vertex and edge reinforcement. And that's something we'll see now in the result. So let's start by vertex self-interaction. So let's define R prime, the asymptotic range of the process. So it's very simple. It's simply the sites which are visited infinitely often. So the V such that Z infinity of V is infinite. And now we take the vertex reinforcement homework, so which is the linear reinforcement. So Pimentel and Volkov conjecture. So okay, there was a first paper by Pimentel and then a more precise paper by Pimentel and Volkov, who conjectured that you would localize on five sites. So Pimentel and Volkov actually prove that with positive probability you will localize on five sites, and the proof is a little bit in the based on the small computation we do here. You say, okay, I know by Borel-Cantelli that I will never visit three on minus three. Now I compute number of visits to two on minus two, and at time n I'll show that it's a small number of visits. And then in the middle here, I have actually a polar urn, which is a little bit disturbed by the visit from 2 and minus 2. So that's the spirit of their proof. So now it's more difficult to prove that it's always the case, because you could imagine, for instance, that you have two clusters, so that there is some sites which are a lot visited in one cluster, and then some sites which are a lot visited in another cluster, but in the middle you have some seldom visited cluster.
And I want to make sure I understand the state.
Yeah.
So are we in one dimension?
We are in dimension one. So G is Z, okay. So it's just Z. And so I showed
so that says that, boy, if I have, is this a vertex? This is a vertex.
Vertex, yes.
It's a vertex, yeah. Force walk. So I'm counting the number of times I've visited the vertices, right? And I'm weighting my thumbs that way. But it's linear. Is it linear?
Yeah, it's linear. So it's W E of N is N plus A.
Okay. So it's a linear vertex reinforcement.
Yeah.
And then the statement is, after a long time, I just set out 5 sites?
Yeah, it's 5 consecutive sites. So I choose 5 consecutive sites on which I localize.
And did I never move out of those sites?
No, never.
Never?
Never, ever. So the 2 sites of the border are seldom visited, and then you have the ones in the middle.
It's trapped in five steps.
And so I gave 2 proofs of this result. So one in 2004 and a new one in 2011, where I used a continuous time version of the work. And actually that ID was key to a later work I did, in particular on edge reinforcement.
But can I ask you, is this expected, something like this expected to be true in higher dimensions?
Yeah, that's what I explained in the next slide. So let's just finish with dimension one. So then the second proof motivated some other results. So one is by Bad Van Schepperensing, where they take a reinforcement which is a bit more than linear, so n log log n. And they show that you can localize either on 4 or 5 sites, the 2 happening with positive probability. But that it is only, these are the only possible cases. And then Kuse, who at that time was my PhD student, proved this conjecture of Erschler, Toth, and Werner about a reinforced random walk. So it's exponentially interacting reinforced random walk, but with competing interactions. So at distance one, so when you are sitting at a site here, so you are repelled by the number of visits to your neighbor here, but you are attracted by the number of visits to. Yeah, you have the mixture of the 2, and you have the parameter which fixes this mixture. And depending on that parameter, you can determine the interval on which, the number of sites on which you will get stuck.
But you will eventually get stuck again.
You will eventually get stuck, yes.
Okay, so that's sort of going into a question that I was sort of wondering, I guess.
Yeah.
It's kind of a reverse question. If you had some notion that you'd like to design a weight, reinforcement function, with a property that as time passes, you sort of uniformly visit sites rather than kind of get focused down really tightly, but you kind of do, it spreads out in a very naturally even way.
Yes.
As if you wanted to sample those nodes. But and kind of provably know that you're kind of getting a balanced sample. Is that?
Yeah, these results are in this direction. The only problem is that they only consider the case of where the graph is z, the integers. So we get a little bit stuck on z. I mean, and I worked a lot on other graphs, and I have to say it was a bit big disappointment for me. I spent years, and I only got results with positive probability. So there was a first paper by Volkov in 2003, and then a paper with Benaim in 2011, which shows that so you can get stuck on finite graph, and actually we know because there is a corresponding dynamics which arises much earlier on in population biology, and it's called replicator dynamics. It was introduced in the in the 20s by Fisher, Wright, and Haldane. And so we can show that you will get stuck on a on set of sites which has the following structure. So it will be a complete dipartite graph plus its outer boundary. And this complete bipartite graph will be interpreted as the supports of equilibria of this dynamics, replicator dynamics. So what does it mean in practice? So let's say, for instance, on Z2. On Z2, you have two types. You can easily show that these are the only cases. So the first is called core and shell. So here, your bipartite graph is always the two parts are blue and red. So the core is here with one site, the shell here, and then in red, and then you have the seldom visited sites, which are in light green. And the other possibility is the square. So here, the two parts are just the diagonals plus the seldom visited sites. So we really tried hard to prove that these results with probability one, and we simply didn't know where to go.
So this is what you observed numerically, or?
Yeah, numerically, we only observe that type of behavior. Although we can show that we gave a counterexample with Michel Benaim, that even on that type of, even here if the weights B, E, and A, E are bounded, we can show that the walk can become very weakly transient. So very slowly it will have to go to infinity. So we know that there can be other type of behavior, but at least when BE is equal to one and AE is equal to one for all edges, we believe that you will get stuck, and we cannot prove it.
So for any A and B linear vertex reinforced, you expect to get stuck, but this is, you can only prove it in certain ranges.
Yes. So now what happens to edge self-interaction? So in some sense, so it's simpler because with conditional Borel-Cantelli lemma, you could prove the following general result, that if W is not reciprocally summable, then either the walk is transient, or if it is not transient, so if one site is visited infinitely often, then all sites, so if your graph is connected, all sites will have to be visited infinitely often. And so it's a simple computation, so that you compute every time the conditional probability. If you visit one site infinitely often, the conditional probability to visit one of its neighbors, and you show that these conditional probability add up to something which is infinite. So now, in this case, what can we say, for instance, about the scaling? So we know very little, except in the linear case, which I'll discuss in a few minutes. So we know from papers by Balintot, the behavior when the graph is Z. So on the line, we know the scaling. And again, here you observe that the scaling is square root of 2 for any self-repellence. So you really need some much stronger self-repellence, actually exponential self-repellence, to see a larger scaling. And so he obtains a convergence in law of xt over t to the nu to a non-trivial and actually non-Gaussian law. And it's diffusion, but here the coefficient, so for weak self weak reinforcement, you have non-diffusive coefficient nu. So it goes from 0 to 1/2 when you alpha goes from 1 to 0. So now what happens to the case where W is reciprocally summable? So from the computations we made from what I explained here, you could get that you would localize. And actually, there was a conjecture by Tom Selke that for any graph of bounded degree, you would localize on one edge. And this conjecture was called the triangle conjecture because it remained upheld for a very long time, even for the case of a triangle. So you take a reciprocally summable W on a triangle, you take edge reinforced random walk, will it choose an edge eventually? So Selke made this conjecture when he proved that you would get stuck on a bipartite graph, and any bipartite graph. Then Vladalimich proved the conjecture when W is a polynomial. Then we proved that conjecture with Vladalimich for any monotone weight. And recently, Kotar and Tucker, with completely different technique, closed the problem. So they proved that you didn't need W to be monotone, that it works also.
So the statement is what? On
any graph of bounded degree, if W is reciprocally summable,
yes,
if you take edge self-infraction, you will eventually choose an edge on which
that
will.
You eventually sit down and go back.
Yeah, you go back and forth on that edge. So now, let me discuss now edge reinforced random walk that in the time that I have left. So the first thing is that it's a very special process. So first, as I said, it sits on the phase transition. Second, it has this property that the probability to do a path only depends on the number of crossings of edges. So it doesn't depend on the order in which you cross these edges. And by a result of Diakonis and Friedman, you can deduce from that property, by that partial exchangeability property, that your walk is a mixture of Markov chains. So in other words, in probabilistic language, it's a random walk in random environment. But now your environment is not independent. It's a highly dependent environment. And it was computed explicitly, so first by Coppersmith in Diakonis in a paper that was never published. And then the computation was published and made in very interesting, with very interesting technical details by Keane and Rollers in 2000. And so now the question that all probabilists ask is it recurrent or transient? So does it come back? Recurrent means that it comes back infinitely often to the starting site, and transient that it will go to infinity. And Pimentel first proved a recurrent phase transition on trees. So note that on trees, your environment will be independent because you'll have, so if you think about the example I gave of the three consecutive sites, you'll have a polyurn sitting at every vertex. Because when you go through an edge, you have to come back through the same edge. So you have simple structure. I mean, still, you need to have this independent structure, and then you need to show that so he showed this phase transition.
So this phase transition occurs in what sense?
So it means that for weak reinforcement, so if A is small, so for weak reinforcement, if A is large, because if A is large, then the impact of the first visit is smaller. So if A is large and it is transient, if A is small, it's recurrent. But he really proves explicitly the phase transition. So he gets explicitly the point of the transition. The reinforcement is you are either, yeah. So it depends on the reinforcement and on the graph. And you get explicitly, and he even studied in detail the phase transition, the case where A is exactly equal to the critical parameter.
That's what I was asking.
Yeah, yesterday.
Does he see the multifractal stuff that we.
So I need to check that.
Okay.
So, and then Merkel and Rollers, the big question was what happens on graphs with cycles. And Merkel and Rollers did a series of work. So they started patiently with the ladder, so the Z, which is the graph like that. And then they did multi-ladder, and eventually they obtained recurrence on the 2D graph, so which is a graph, so it's not exactly Z2, but you replace each edge by a certain number of small edges. So it adds some regularity to the structure, but still it belongs to the same class somehow. And so they showed recurrence for, I mean, they showed what in statistical physics we call localization. And they showed recurrence in some cases.
This is true for high reinforcement or for all reinforcement?
So the localization in terms of statistical physics is always true, but it's polynomial decrease. And then you can deduce recurrence only if you have certain enough number edges here in your graph and for a high reinforcement, so for a small.
So it's almost back to the one-dimensional case in some ways.
Yeah, I mean, still it's...
No, it's still not trivial.
Yeah, it's still not trivial. And it will turn out that clearly that the result then could be used with this random Schrödinger link to prove recurrence on Z2, so it's still...
But that's a different paper.
Yes, it's a different paper, sure, yeah. So, okay, so let me now, in the time that I have left, okay, I've been a bit slow, so discuss the link, so the new approach, which is a link with statistical physics. So the first is the link between edge reinforcement and work, and another process, which is called vertex reinforcement process. Which is the following. So you start from a fixed site, and you have some conductances Wij, so on non-oriented edges. And then when you are sitting at I, you jump to J, to your neighbor J, at a rate which is Wij multiplied by the local time at J. So the local time with the convention that initially your local time is 1 at time 0. So it was proposed by Werner, and actually initially it was proposed as similar to the vertex reinforcement work, although it turns out to have very different behavior. And so it was first studied on trees by Davis and Volkov. And so we showed with Christophe Sabot, we showed that the edge reinforced random walk with weights AE is equal in law to the vertex reinforced jump process with random conductances, which has gamma distribution, gamma of AE independent. The conductances are independent. So you look at the vertex reinforced jump process, but you look at the trace of that walk at the times at which it jumps. So you just look at your path, and it is equal in law if you take these random conductances. And so this property is not particular to edge reinforcement, it's due to linearity. So the first time it was observed, this was actually for vertex reinforcement, you have similar property, and it was in the paper I mentioned earlier, that you have this equivalence. Obviously, the other time-continuous processes are less tractable than the vertex reinforcement process.
So the statement here is that if I have edge-reinforced walk, that it is equivalent to a random walk in a random environment.
Yes.
With the environment have random conductances.
That's true, but the thing, it's a good question, because here the subtlety will be that in the end we'll show that the vertex reinforcement jump process itself is a mixture of Markov chains. So instead of having, as for standard random walk in random environment, you have two layers of randomness. You have your environment. Once you fix your environment, you have Markov chain. So here we'll end up with three layers of randomness. So one is with the weights, the conductances W. Once you fix the conductances W, you can show that the vertex reinforced jump process will be a mixture of Markov chains. So then the environment of the mixture will be a second layer, and then the Markov chain will give you the third layer of randomness. So I don't have time to explain how you go from edge reinforced random walk to vertex reinforced jump process. So although it's rather simple, but really interesting. So now let me explain how you go from vertex reinforced jump process to the supersymmetric model. So we take the following. So we assume that our graph is finite. We take a number of vertices n. So we let pi0 be the law of your vertex reinforced jump process starting from i0. And we do a change of time. So the change of time is easy to justify, because if you take the original time scale, you speed up. You know that you add up local time as time goes on, so you'll jump faster and faster. So you have no chance to be a mixture of Markov chains. But it will turn out that you are a mixture. This process is a mixture of Markov chain if you slow it down. So if you slow down at every site the time. And so the way you slow down the time is that you take Li, small Li, to be the big Li, the squared minus one, where Li was the local time we had initially. So it's a deterministic time change. And under that deterministic time change, you can show that the vertex reinforced jump process is a mixture of Markov jumps processes with jump rate, which is wij e to the uga minus ui over 2. So to summarize, what have we done? So first, we showed that the edge reinforced framework was somehow a mixture of vertex reinforced jump process with random conductances. So now in this theorem, we say we fix these conductances. And having fixed these conductances, then my vertex reinforced jump process is a mixture of Markov jump processes. And the random parameter here will be u. And u has this law, which is given by this supersymmetric hyperbolic model, sigma model. So it's the following. So here you have a normalization, which looks like a Gaussian normalization. But now you see that your Hamiltonian here is not just quadratic, I mean, at least in standard variables. So your Hamiltonian is twice the sum over wij of the square of the hyperbolic sine of ui minus uj over 2. And then you have a term here, square root of a determinant, which you can interpret with matrix tree theorem type result by a sum over spanning trees of the product over the spanning trees of wij e to the ui plus uj. And then you can interpret that measure as a Gibbs measure on a supermanifold extension of the hyperbolic plane.
So the u is some kind of potential at every node?
Yes. Yeah, exactly.
And it just has a distribution according to
you. Yeah, it has this distribution, this really interesting distribution.
It's a fairly complicated distribution, but this is the one that Coppersmith, roughly speaking, the one that Coppersmith and the economists found, right?
It's
very close to it.
It looks like this, yeah, it looks like this, but there were, yeah. So let me discuss, so how much time do I have left?
Well, maybe 10 minutes or so.
10 minutes, okay, good. So I'll discuss quickly. So it's more, obviously I won't have time to go into the details of this paper, which are quite technical, but I'll give you an intuition on the other links. So one is with random Schrödinger. So the idea is quite simple. It's the following. You say I take these betas, so these variable betas are very natural to introduce, because except at i0, they are simply the jump rate from I. So you take the jump rate from I, but at i0 you add an independent random variable. So we'll see later why you have to add that. So these are the jump rates, and then so it will create a field. So we'll say, we have to say, so for now I don't say where beta lives. It's actually not so easy question. But you can get an intuition of why they are one dependent. So they are independent at distance two. And the intuition is very simple. It's the following. If you take, so let's take the simpler case where you take two betas, which are distance two. So let's take, you take one here at I and another at 1j here. So now here you have your neighbors, and here you have your other neighbors. So now if you want to study this work, so this vertex reinforced jump process, but you just want to know the asymptotic jump rate, what you only care about this part, because every time you go out, you know that you have, so you can glue all the sides, all the neighbors here. And you know that every time you go out, you have to go through one of these edges. So actually, you can make a correspondence between this and the graph, the simple graph, which is just one edge, I, j, and where you add, you take wi here, where wi is the sum of all the conductances from I to j. And you can do the same here. So you have some independent behavior, and that's okay. That gives you a quick intuition of why you have. Okay, so the statement here is more general because you take now a vector on set of sides which are at distance greater than or equal to 2. So now you can show that if the W are constant, your beta is translation invariant. So again, you can kind of guess it from the explanation I gave now. And actually, you can show that, for instance, if the W are stationary, then the beta I will be stationary. And you can compute the marginals by this argument, for instance, to show that they are inverse Gaussian law. They have inverse Gaussian law. So now, where do the beta live? So to do that, you have to make introduce the following definition. So the discrete Laplacian on the graph with conductances W. And then you introduce h beta, which is minus Laplacian, to plus 2 beta minus w. So w is wi here, so it lies on the diagonal. And so the beta, we can show that the beta lie on the set on which a beta is positive definite. And so this implies in particular that the green function, h beta to the minus 1, has positive entries, because it's an M matrix. We can compute the distribution of beta. It has the following formula. So, okay, so now how, yeah.
Go back to that. Yeah. H beta there.
Yeah.
Now, let's see, where did it go? In the next slide.
Yeah, so now the idea is that, so, if you want to go from u to beta, you add this independent random variable with gamma 1/2 distribution. So now, how can you do the reverse? So go from beta to u. And the way you do it is the following. So you take actually, so OK, the interesting thing here is that the distribution on beta won't.
Can I stop you for a second? The h yeah. beta.
Yes.
No. Okay. You have, yeah. So that Laplacian, is that the ordinary Laplacian, or is that the Laplacian you have above, which is?
Yeah, it's a discrete Laplacian. Yes. Yeah, it's
this
delta.
Yeah, but you're using. I thought the W's were random, so I'm a bit confused.
You thought it was
random.
No, so the randomness comes from beta.
Yeah.
So if you fix beta,
yeah,
it's not random.
It's confusing because I thought the W was random.
No, but now when I take VRJP, I fix the conductances W. So first I said, okay, edge reinforced random walk is vertex reinforced jump process with random conductances W. But all the rest, I fix W. And for instance, when I say that you have this supersymmetric hyperbolic sigma model, it's for fixed W, right? So So and here it's the same. So I fix W and then I say I take minus discrete Laplacian plus 2 beta minus W with beta which has this random distribution. And note that, though, an interesting feature of this distribution is it doesn't depend on the initial site. So it enables, for instance, to couple the distribution of the U starting from different sites. And now the way you retrieve, so we saw how to go from U to beta, so by computing the jump rates and then adding at the initial site this gamma 1/2 random variable. And how do you go from beta to U? So you take the green function at from I0 to I, and you normalize it by the corresponding. So if you want UI0 to be 0, right? Okay, so I think I'll stop with that. So then, okay, we have also, okay, let me say quickly for those who know about second Reinheit theorem. So the idea is that you have a relationship between the Gaussian free field and the local time of Markov jump processes. So, which is the following: you take a Gaussian free field phi. Yeah. So, okay. Yeah. So here I should have introduced more notation. So, PGU is a law of the Gaussian free field on that graph, and then you add, you take the square of this Gaussian free field divided by 2. You add some local time, and it's equal in law to the square of the Gaussian free field by tilted at by square root of 2u. So what you did is we took the local time of your Markov jump process by which stopped at the time at which the local time at the initial site where it was equal to u. And so then actually we can show that the law of the phi here knowing the initial phi knowing the final phi can be retrieved by a magnetized version of the reverse VRGP, so which is actually dual to the vertex reinforcement process. But okay, it would need many more explanations. Okay, thanks for your attention.